terrific speech you made last night, sir.
Well,
I think that thrilled the whole nation.
I don't know. I did the best I could.
As a matter of fact, I think it was the best speech of that type I ever heard.
Well, thank you, thank you. Got a good reaction in the country, but I don't know how long it'll last.
I'm sure it'll last.
You still got the problem in your country company you had before?
There hasn't been much change, Mr. President.
I sure wish you'd come down here and be Secretary of Treasury, but I don't want to offer it to you to accept.
No, of course not.
I don't want to get you problems, and I don't want to get any. And
of course not.
They've got a dozen speculated on, none of whom I really given thought to. But I thought of three or four business people, and our balance payments are awfully rough, and we got this program working now, and the last several weeks, it's very much on the plus side, and Martin thinks the banks are working and other things, and I think there's some way you could take a year or two off.
Well, you know, sir, that I have absolutely no background in that area, and that every time I have one of those kind of decisions to make here in IBM, I have to rely on other people. And I have real misgivings about it. Now, I ought to tell you another thing. Mary Rockefeller just left here a few minutes ago, and she's Lawrence's wife. She was in here on the YWCA business. But mm-hmm. As she left, I said, Mary, what's the story on David and going to work in Washington? And I'm sure you're current on this, but I pass it on in case it may some help.
No, I'm not.
And she said, we were talking to him not long ago out in the country, and he said that this was the sort of thing that if he was ever really called on to do it, he would have to give it serious consideration. Now, earlier in the game, he had come to me and asked me what I thought of that job in connection with your administration, and I told him I thought it'd be the greatest thing in the world. Maybe somebody had made an overture to him. I don't know any of the background.
No, nobody has.
And he asked me whether I thought he could work with you, and I said that I thought that on an unqualified basis that he would work with you in a beautiful way, and he seemed to be heartened by that. Now, this was, I guess, in late December or early January, and I haven't heard anything more about it since. But then today, when I read the speculation about Don, why then I thought the matter might be open, and I just thought I'd throw that out to Mary, and she did come back with that answer, which might be of some help to you.
Well, it is. I had two questions about him, which I'll talk to you very confidentially and frankly about. I didn't know how he felt about our money policy, and I'm very fearful that some of my New York banks are going to jump my interest rates, and I think if we develop a tight money policy, and it's been developing a little bit, that we could slow down our economy some, and I have enough problems with Martin and keeping him loosened up a little, if 5 or 6 members of his board all the time, that are wanting to tighten her up. And the average banker, and I've been one, I thank God I haven't got any advertisement that way, but we are the first ones that get our raise before the labor unions and before you mark up your machine and before anybody else. The banks always increase the interest, and they feel like they can do it without a contract or without a union agreement or without any profits or anything else. And I've got a big problem with my Federal Reserve making them keep enough money out to keep this interest rate down. And any excuse they find, they raise the hell out of it. And they're just as dumb as they can be. It doesn't make any difference what happens. George Humphrey, he just comes along here and he creates $12 billion deficit for Eisenhower. While he had the best intentions in the world, he's just like my little daughter when she gets a hold of a can of gasoline and walks around the fireplace. She's not really a criminal, but she's just inadequate to the problem. And I was afraid that he listened to George Champion a little bit.
Well, I doubt if he would, sir. He had to live with George Champion in there, but he's a very liberally minded
guy. He is, but I don't know how he is on money.
I don't think he ever associated himself with the position of the New York bankers in that balance of payments committee, which we worked on down there last year. He was always quite a different thinker than the head of the guaranteed trust and so forth. So, I'm not a technical fellow, so I can't guarantee it, but my guess is that with his exposure as LaGuardia's secretary years ago, and LaGuardia's pretty liberal, I don't think he's going to follow any policies set by New York bankers in his own thinking.
Well, some of our friends had raised that question about... he had expressed a time or two that he thought we kind of had to keep this thing tightened up a little. The second question I raised was the problem of Nelson. Nelson's ambitious, and Nelson wants to be nominated, and Nelson wants to run.
Yeah.
And a man's got to be loyal to his brother, and we all want him to, and expect
him
to.
That's a real consideration.
And what would he do sitting in my cabinet when we're planning how to cut his brother's throat?
Yeah, I hadn't thought. I think that's probably a real valid.
For that reason, I never talked to anybody to talk to him or hadn't given him any consideration. I have given consideration to Bob Roosa, who was the undersecretary.
Well, I thought Bob Roosa was terribly, terribly good. And I'm sure that if he was secretary, he'd do an excellent job. And if you could ever get him to come back and support somebody else, that they both do a good job.
That's right.
And you thought of this fellow who's head of the New York Federal Reserve District.
They just say he is Hayes.
Yeah.
Oh, God, he's a whole lot worse than these fellows here on tight money.
Oh, really?
He's just a raising hell now. He's one of five the other day that demanded they jump him up already.
Well, my guess is that Roosa would find universal acceptance among regions.
They say I got lots of problems with him on the Hill. You have no idea how many problems you got touching base with everybody. They say he's not acclimated up there. He doesn't get along up there. He's a technical international money man, highly skilled and highly technical and very knowledgeable and very able. But as a man that can get through your tax bill, it's just like I becoming a jet pilot.
Yeah.
And that's the problem there. I've given some consideration to Bill Youngman, who...
I know Bill very well.
He's a Phi Beta Kappa from Harvard, very able fella, but most of his international experience is out in the Pacific area. Not where our real problems are with France and others. And he's, some of them think we wouldn't go so well.
He's not very well known, but my guess is that if Bill was ever tapped for something down there, that he would get well known and be universally accepted. I think he's a man of great capacity.
They say Francis Dillon doesn't think he's heavy enough for you. I've always thought he was a pretty able fella. His academic background is exceptional, and looks like he's made his insurance things go, and it looks like they say he's too retiring, too shy, not well enough known, and not knowledgeable enough about international monetary matters that De Gaulle would screw him to death.
I don't know about monetary matters, but I don't think you'd have any trouble on shyness. And in the non-technical areas, I think he's a man of great substance. You know, he'd been in government, as you know.
Yeah, he's with
out, and he has made a tremendous success of that company, which was put together by a kind of a hard-driving fellow who really didn't know how to tie up the ends. And Bill has done a superb job in making it a really dependable company. So I have nothing but praise for Bill Youngman.
Kermit Gordon has been talked about a good deal. He was on the Council of Economic Advisors under Kennedy.
Yeah.
He directed the budget. Some of them say he's too professorial.
I suppose your banker friends would be happier if you could find a banker.
They all say they'd be happier if you could find somebody that was a little more conservative than Kermit is.
Yeah. I myself would feel he'd be great, but you've got to please the banking community. And getting back to me, I think the banking community would be aghast at me because they all know that I don't know anything except how to borrow money. I borrowed a lot around here, but that's about my only contact with banking.
I had an interesting thing. I've gotten 1,436 pro telegram and 82 cons.
Well, that ought to give you a little heart, Mr. President.
Harry Truman says you have expressed in unmistakable terms the conscience of the nation and the historical commitment of the nation's position on civil rights. You should have unqualified support, and you have all of mine, Harry Truman.
Yeah, that's great. Well, I thought that it was the most forceful speech I ever saw anybody make when they were trying to lead a large group of people. I never saw you come through as strongly as that, nor anybody else come through on television that strongly.
Republicans didn't want to get up, you know, when I told them about when I was a kid and I was teaching in school and I went home. I never thought I'd be president, but I was, and I was going to do something about it, and I had this power, and I meant to use it. And I looked over, and they wouldn't get up at all, and all the Democrats were up, and I looked at old Keith from New Jersey and Hugh Scott and Dirksen, and I looked at the camera, and I just put my head back, and I'd look at them, and then I looked at the camera. They looked, saw the damn cameras on them, and I wish you'd seen them get up.
I saw them get up, but I didn't know how to do it all.
That's what I was doing. And they all of them had glue in their britches, and they was just stuck, and they wouldn't come at all. But when I saw that camera start circling around on them, that little red light, it was the funniest thing I ever saw.
Well, that was a stroke of genius. Well, they damn well ought to have gotten up because it was magnificent.
Well, Tom, how well do you know David?
David? I think I could say that I knew him intimately, sir.
Why don't you buy him a drink if he's around and ask him what he thinks about that you hear that they're going to raise the prime rate, that you understand we're lending money up, we're paying 4 3/8 and lending 4.5, and that's not enough for any bank to get by on according to what you hear, but that you know I don't want it raised because it's going to tighten it up. It looks like the banker's going to have to raise it. And what does he think about it? And how does he feel about my general monetary views of trying to make the dollar sound as a dollar and gold good as gold, but try to keep ample money around so people can have some expansion? And whether he would feel like Dylan or whether he would feel like Champion.
I'd be delighted to do that.
Fill it out quick as you can. I just got 12 days to send a nomination up and get him confirmed, and I can't let De Gaulle mess with me one day without a secretary. And I don't know that this would work out. I would never suggest to him that at all, but I would just feel around.
Oh, I certainly wouldn't.
And give me a reading on it, and I've given more thought to him since I started talking to you and anybody. I'm crazy about this Lawrence. He just does more good work for poor people.
Yeah, he's a great fellow in every way.
I just hope he doesn't get called on like you do too much. I'm just afraid that we all impose on you too much, but because you are one of a few and
well, Mr. President,
so good.
You couldn't possibly impose on me, and I will get the pitch on this as soon as I possibly can and be back to you.
Thank you.
All right, sir. Bye.